Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, Laura.
Good morning, Laura.
Good morning, Laura.
Good morning, Laura.
Yes. Well, now if anyone has trouble finding a seat this morning, please don't push and shove. We can put out extra chairs if necessary. But I thank you, our loyal Salem United Methodist family members. I realize that this is a bit of a change, and it is a change that for all of us can be challenging. I know this morning, normally I get up early, as most of you know, but I get up early, but I don't have anything to do. This morning I got up early and I had something to do. So if I, so I may join John in dozing off during my sermon this morning. But nonetheless, I thank you for joining us on this beautiful 4th of July day. Now, you know, one of the things that happens in churches on the 4th of July is sometimes pastors become very uneasy. Do we celebrate the 4th of July, or do we simply celebrate this as another day of worship? And quite frankly, throughout my ministry, I have always seen that the two go together very well. The very gift of freedom that we celebrate on this day is truly a gift from God. And it's a gift that we have now been entrusted to carry forward. And so it is not so much celebrating a historical event of a declaration of independence, the birth of a nation. It's celebrating a legacy that is now entrusted to us. And a legacy entrusted to us to carry forward as followers of Jesus Christ. And so we begin this 4th of July worship as we do each time the people of Salem United Methodist Church gather, with this powerful affirmation, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Are there announcements this morning? Well, everyone is remarkable. I guess we should continue meeting earlier and earlier than the
Well, that's all right.
I do have.
Yes, go right ahead.
Next week we're going to try and start having a coffee hour after service. I'll bring some munchy something, and Adam can make a pot of coffee, and we can just sit and chit chat for a little bit.
You woke
something
up.
We haven't been doing for quite a while, and kind of miss it.
Sounds good. Thank you, Adam.
So plan to stay.
Also, we received this week, and actually, I received a copy of this, and then June, I have a copy for you in your role as lay leader. May not be able to see this. This is a picture of our new district superintendent. Now, this is Reverend Marty Lundy, who I really enjoy working with. She has been the pastor at a church, a Methodist church in Indiana, for some 21 years. I believe she's been at Huntington. Her husband is also a pastor on deployment with the Air Force. He's a chaplain in the Air Force. When she was named, and as you may recall, our prior district superintendent, Sunita, has now been moved to another district. When Reverend Lundy was named, she visited every church in the North District, and there's some 145 churches, and had her picture taken. So here is her picture in front of Salem United Methodist Church on a very cold and snowy day last winter. Now, I did apologize to her for calling the sheriff's department for a trespasser, but she seems to have forgiven us. So I think we are going to truly enjoy and benefit from working with Dr. Lundy. All right. If there are no further announcements, let us be about the reason we have gathered on this 4th of July as we celebrate the call to worship.
Please stand as you are able for the call to worship, which can be found inside your bulletin.
Still do that.
We gather today having each walked a different journey.
We gather in celebration of those journeys.
We gather today having each known great joy and deep sorrow.
We gather united in hope.
We gather today having each experienced the gift of freedom.
We gather united in Christ. Come, Spirit of the living God, dwell with us.
Please join us in our opening hymn, America, on page 697, and we will be singing verses 1 and 4 with an introduction.
Our country's in America.
Christ's love and a sign of the peace that we know only through.
Good morning, dear.
Hello! A big crowd here.
How are you doing, sweetie?
This will take some time to get around to.
What's your hurry?
We're gonna settle down this big crowd. All right. Herb, sit down.
You can feel the love. Why do I bother? All right.
As we return to being somewhat normal. You too, Lauren, sit down.
You can feel the love.
This is not a good hour to tangle with me.
Don't mess with Laura.
Too early in the morning.
Well, again, I thank you for coming. I realized when I noticed that the very first day of our new service time would be the 4th of July, I did have some concerns because it is historically one of those low attendance days. And so I thank each of you for coming, and I know it is a change, and change is never easy. But even in the midst of change, one thing remains constant, and that is that we experience God. We experience God in every element of life. Now this morning, our sanctuary candle, that's up there somewhere, our sanctuary candle is in honor of Brian Rado's birthday.
Oh.
On the 8th, I think it's the 8th this week, Brian will be 29 years old.
Wow.
So,
oh,
yeah.
How about that?
Making you an old man, John.
Oh,
yes.
Now wait a minute, he's old, not me.
Oh, you.
John's aging rapidly, trust me. But no, we celebrate. This is actually one of those months where we have a lot of birthdays. Today, for example, our sister in Christ, Chris Wallace, celebrates her birthday on July 4th. She's July 4th baby. Zane will have his birthday on the 8th, along with Brian. Debbie Meter on the 9th. And Mid Fraley will celebrate her birthday on the 10th of July. So it is a busy first couple of weeks in the month of July, and we celebrate those with great joy. Other joys this morning. Yes, John.
It's a joy to have Brian here for a few days. He's leaving tomorrow. So. And for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Well, that's great. I'm glad he could do that, you know. I'm glad he could do that, and he actually probably prefers being here than in Ireland, right?
I don't know.
It's a close call.
It's a close call, I know. It's a close call. But no, I'm happy for you guys. That's great. Yes, Joe.
Thankful. Last night we had our firework display, and everything went great.
Oh, where did you have your fireworks display?
At Stony Run.
That's what I thought. Now that's the reason I couldn't sleep last night. So, yes.
Yes.
It sounded really good.
Very
always
good.
Always thankful afterwards of being Andy are in one piece.
That's very good. All right. Also, it is a time when, yes, Donna.
We had a great time this past week going up to Brenda's in Michigan and being with our grandson who is 13 and now taller than I am.
Wow. That's great. Yes, Jeff.
One more thing. I was in Strax until a couple of days ago and seen Pastor Sherry and Pastor Jim there.
Oh, good. So very
talked
good.
Talked to them for a while.
That's great. How are they doing?
They're doing real good.
All right. It is also a time when we lift up our concerns. And we do that not because we believe that God has to be told what God needs to do in each of our lives, but because there are times that we want to surrender those things in our life and surrender all things in our life to God for strength, for hope. And moreover, there are times when we want to know that we do not walk a journey alone. So are there concerns this morning? Yes, Penny.
Yes, last week we prayed for my employee's grandma, Miss Majors. She passed away Thursday.
Oh. Other concerns, yes.
Please pray for the brave folks that are attempting to recover bodies from the disaster in Florida.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Other concerns this morning? How is Johanna doing?
She's doing good. We visited her a couple of days ago and...
Yesterday.
Yesterday. And she's doing really good.
All right. Let us center ourselves in the presence of a living God, a God who knows the moment of our life and resides in those deepest places of our being, those places where thoughts that are unspoken are held, those places where our concerns are kept and our fears reside, but yet also the place where God resides with great joy, dwelling with us, being with us, transforming us. Holy and living God, we come to you today as the people of this great community of faith, a community of faith that has served your kingdom for decades, a community of faith that united together in the face of war, pandemic, depression, a community that has always persevered in carrying forward the message of the gospel. And today we pray in great joy for the gift of life as we celebrate birthdays for Brian Rado, Chris Wallace, St. Jeffers, Debbie Meter, Mitt Fraley. We thank you for each of these lives, for every life is a precious gift, a gift that can reveal your kingdom and your love and your hope. We pray in thanksgiving and we pray for safety for all people with fireworks on this day of celebration. We pray that you may protect them, hold them with your protective love. We pray for the family of Miss Majors and may they look upon the legacy of her life and find hope. And may they find peace in the promise of Easter dawn. We pray for those brave workers in the Florida building collapse. We pray for the families. We pray that your healing presence may surround and comfort them. May your protection guide them. And may your wisdom lead them to do their job in an effective and compassionate manner. We pray in thanksgiving for Johanna. Sustain her in her recovery. Grant her strength. Grant her renewed hope. Encourage her and nurture her. We pray in thanksgiving that Donna and Adam were able to be with Tyler, and we thank you so much for nurturing him. Continue to guide him so he may grow to be a powerful witness of the gospel truth and the hope that resides in you. And we pray for our sister and brother in ministry, Sherry and Jim, continue to comfort and guide and strengthen them as they go forward. May their ministries continue to be fruitful, and may they reveal to the world the power of your love, the hope of your grace, and the truth of your word. We pray all of this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of confession, which can be found inside your bulletin. Holy God, we rejoice that you are a God of the unimaginable, the unpredictable, and the miraculous. Yet we often fail to see the miraculous works of your hands in our daily lives. By your grace, forgive us for those times when we have failed to witness the wonder of your mighty acts, in both the smallest moments of our lives and in the greatest challenges of human history. Open our hearts to your truth, so that we may be messengers of the good news. In Jesus' name, amen.
We now enter into silent prayer and meditation. And as I say each week, silent prayer does not simply mean not speaking. Silent prayer is about experiencing God. And experiencing God in a very special way when we rise above the circumstances of our life. Now, all of us have many things to do today. We have no doubt family or friends coming, and we have things that are going to make this a very busy one or two days for us. But yeah, we need to rise above that now and just experience the presence of God. In today's gospel, we hear two stories. One, the story of how Jesus is rejected in his own hometown. And then the story of how Jesus sends forth the disciples. And the reason Jesus was rejected in his hometown was that the people could not rise above the markers of his identity. He said, isn't this the son of Mary, the carpenter? They didn't see him as a rabbi, a prophet. Didn't see him as the Messiah. They could not rise above the way they knew him. And so as we center ourselves in the presence of God, I want us to experience what it's like to rise above the identities that we have given ourselves, but that society has given us. Rise above those identities and simply experience being a child of God. The past doesn't matter. The future need not be feared. The failures no longer count, and the successes no longer matter. You are simply a beloved child of God. Center yourself in that experience. Center yourself in that love. Amen. One of the great lessons of Christian faith is to move above the markers of identity that the world has given us and to move among the markers of identity that we have given ourselves over the years. And when we do that, we then can truly experience God, because it is the markers that we self-impose in our life that make us want to control everything. We want to atone for our past mistakes. We want to compete for new successes. But when we rise above that, then we truly know what it means to be a child of God and to no longer seek to control, but merely to experience God's grace. Now, in today's epistle, we hear a great deal about hardship. And I always had trouble with that when I was growing up, because I wanted to think that if you were a Christian, you didn't endure any hardship. But I soon learned that was really a very bad and very limited, superficial interpretation of what faith is all about. Witnessing the kingdom of God is done in the midst of human history, is it not? And perhaps the message is that we testify amid that reality. We testify amid a reality of hate-filled speech, of fear, of physical suffering, of greed, of natural disaster. Yet that is where our work begins. And that is why our work is so necessary and needed and inescapable. So as we lift our prayers and petitions this morning, let us do so ever mindful of the reality of our own mission field. Please respond, hear our prayer. For the church of your Son, our Lord and Savior and Redeemer, to be a beacon of hope, a place of light, and a messenger of the good news, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
For Salem United Methodist Church, in our 177th year of gospel witness, to continue to proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to continue to advocate for freedom for all people, and continue to stand and live as the body of your Son, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
For the victims of the tragedy in Florida, for families who have suffered, for first responders, demolition workers, that they may know that they are guided by your healing presence, that your wisdom may enlighten those who grieve, your hope may fill the hearts of those who worry, and may that scene of despair be a sight where your love is revealed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For our nation, on this day of our nation's birth, that we acknowledge that we are called to be a people of justice, a community of love, an advocate of hope, and a source of healing for a broken land. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For all who suffer and all who grieve, that the legacy of lives lived well, the hope that resides in knowing your strength, and the peace that we find in the promise of Easter dawn may fill their lives, strengthen their hearts, and nurture them in very special ways. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
To those prayers that reside only in the silence of our hearts and minds and the depths of our being, where there is despair, grant hope. Where there is fear, peace. Where there is pain, comfort. And where there is brokenness, compassion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We now gather our prayers together, born of the circumstances of our lives, and we unite them in the perfect prayer our Lord and Savior gave us, as the people of Salem United Methodist Church join together and say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The epistle reading this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 10. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible things, things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so that no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. This morning's gospel is from Mark chapter 6, verses 1 through 13. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out, two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Did you ever wonder why we launch fireworks on the 4th of July? You know, when you think about it, right? What better way to celebrate the birth of a nation of freedom and equality, with government by the people, for the people, and of the people, by launching projectiles that could unintentionally blow up your neighbor's garage? Nothing says happy 4th of July like that. But actually, fireworks started because of John Adams. He wrote, with the Declaration of Independence, he wrote back to his wife and he said, this day shall be a day of celebration with illuminations in the sky and guns going off and cannon salutes. And now the reason he can do that is because he was away from home. Had he said this stuff to his wife when he was at home, she would have said, sure, illuminate your own sky, buddy, but not at our house. And that's the reality. We make so much of the celebration of the 4th of July, we forget about the reality of the 4th of July. Because we look at this day as simply a historical event. We look at it as a point in history in 1776, when America decided that they would declare their freedom from Great Britain, that they would break away, knowing what the cost would be, from the British Empire. Now think about what was going on at that time. You had a rough confederacy of colonies, much disagreement. They were all different. All 13 colonies were very, very different. You had British troops essentially enforcing British control. You had a number of British loyalists among the colonists. It was not uniform to be an independent nation, to grow a nation. And there was even a great debate about what the nation would look like, how the colonies would relate to one another, and what would happen if there was a central government, and how would they prevent a monarchy? All of those things were entering into the mind of the people who were declaring independence. And so what we celebrate on the 4th of July, we celebrate an improbable idea. And it was. It was an improbable idea. There was no legitimate evidence that it would work. In fact, there was a lot of evidence that they would fail in their grand endeavor, that they would not secure independence. In fact, that they would probably incur harsher control from the King of England, from King George. But in that improbable idea, there were three things that compelled them. The first thing was the idea of freedom, not the kind of freedom that we may think about today, We think about freedom as our ability to move freely on our daily, the things we do on a daily basis. We think of freedom as simply our right to choose to do certain things or elect not to do other things. No, their idea of freedom was that idea of self-determination. That a nation, a people, a community should be able to determine of their own accord and with their own mind and with their own objectives, their future. The second thing that compelled them was this idea of hope. They knew full and well that it would be a difficult journey to build a nation, even if they could defeat the crown. They knew it would be difficult. They knew the states or colonies wouldn't agree with one another. They knew that there would be loyalists to Great Britain that would continue to be a detriment to the new nation. But they had hope that somewhere in those ideals, they would prevail. And the final thing that encouraged those writers of the Declaration of Independence, that we talk about it, but I don't think we accept it, was faith. Now, it's very easy for people to bring together religion and government and all of those things and combine politics and faith. That's not what they were talking about. They were talking about a real, true belief in God. Not belief in a denomination, not belief in a person, but they believed in freedom, which they saw as a gift from God. They believed in hope, which they saw as a gift from God, and they believed the only way to carry those gifts forward was through faith. And if you go back and you read the sermons that were given prior to the signing of the Declaration of Independence in the congregational churches that many of the signers attended, you would hear those three things. That this would be a nation founded on freedom for all people. That this would be a nation born of hope. And that this would be a nation of faith. Those are the lights that guided this nation to be formed. Now, people are very quick to say, we have never truly attained those great ideals, have we? And into each generation of history is handed the pen that must write the next story. And it is not enough to simply look back and look at other generations and say you failed. We have to look at our generation now, our people now, and say, how are we writing that story of faith and of hope and of faith? And are we doing it as the Christian church? Are we doing it really in the way the founders intended? Or are we doing it in the way that's comfortable for us? I said before, when I was talking in the pastoral prayer, that one of the reasons Jesus was not accepted in his own hometown was because people couldn't rise above the identity markers that he had. His family, his career, his profession, his occupation, his siblings. And sometimes I think we as a nation fail to rise above the identity markers that we have given ourselves. And recognize that that even though no generation has ever attained those lofty ideals, that each generation has to rise above their own identity markers to carry forward that great and grand story. And the second story in the gospel is the idea today of being sent forth. Sent forth by Jesus, the disciples, they too were being sent forth in an improbable idea. The whole idea of a nation of freedom, a nation of hope, a nation of faith, a nation of government by the people, for the people, and of the people is an improbable idea. It goes against the very core of individualism. It goes against the very core of being committed only to our own well-being and our comfort. It's an improbable idea. The fact that the kingdom of God could be proclaimed by a group of ordinary men and carried out throughout among the Israelites was an improbable idea. But they were sent forth. And so on this 4th of July, my challenge to each of you and my challenge to myself is, we have to accept the fact that the spirit of this nation is an improbable idea. Every strand of evidence says it can't work, but every longing of the human heart says that it must. And just as those disciples were sent forth to follow an improbable ideal, so are we. And so has been every generation at Salem Methodist Church for 177 years. It was an improbable idea that the kingdom of God could be proclaimed during the Civil War, but yet Pastor Connor did that and the church united. It was an improbable idea that a spirit of hope could be proclaimed during the Spanish flu epidemic. But Pastor Johnson did that at Salem Methodist Episcopal Church. And it was indeed difficult to believe that faith could be proclaimed during World War II, during Pearl Harbor. But yet, at Salem Methodist Church, faith was proclaimed. That torch has now been handed to each one of us to live as the people of this community, to claim that improbable idea, and no matter the obstacle, no matter the impediment, no matter the challenge, to carry it forward. And as Jesus told the disciples, there will be those who do not accept. There will be those who want to be locked in their own identity. There will be those who do not believe that freedom is right. There will be those who do not believe equality is right. There will be those who create their own sociology, their own anthropology. But that's not our mission. Our mission is to be a people of freedom, a people of hope, and a people of faith. Now, in closing, I'd like you to close your eyes. I want you to think about one thing. You've been handed an improbable idea to carry forward. And this week, there's something in your life where you can carry that ideal forward. Perhaps it is speaking justice in the face of hate. Perhaps it is speaking peace in the face of anger. But think about that. Think about how you can carry that improbable idea of freedom, of hope, and of faith forward. Grasp for that picture. God has just given you that message. God has just given you that mission. God has just sent you forth. Amen.
Amen.
One of the great things we read in Scripture, and the more we read Scripture, the more we see the centrality of a meal. Jesus often ministered at a meal. Jesus would often call people together, and people that the community would not accept to join together at a meal. But a meal was a sign of a sacred welcoming. And as we come to this table, and as we prepare to go forward on our own mission, we need to be nourished, don't we? And just as we have to be physically nourished each day, we need to be spiritually nourished in this meal. And what is this nourishment then? This is nourishment based on that improbable idea that God created the world, that God spoke through prophets, that God sent His Son to reveal His truth, to call us into fellowship. The improbable idea that God's Spirit dwells with us now so that we can be disciples and messengers of the good news. And let us pray that our hearts may be cleansed, our minds may be opened, our lives may be surrendered to be nurtured by this sacred meal. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so with your people on earth. And the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection. You gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, calling each of them by name. And he calls us each by name this morning, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, as he gives it to us today, calling us each by name, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now today we're doing things just a bit differently. I will distribute the bread, and then please take the communion cup, small wafer. We did not have communion cups this morning, our apologies. Simply take the juice, and then you can leave the cup in the basket on the table.